Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the book of Genesis, the 32nd chapter, beginning with the 22nd verse. We continue this morning with the story of Jacob. Jacob is now on his way home. God has told him that the time has come for him to return home and make amends with his brother. On the evening before Jacob is to be reunited with his brother, he has an encounter with God, and we read this familiar story. The same night, Jacob arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and everything else that he had. And Jacob was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day has broken." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And Jacob said to and the man said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the name of the place Penuel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been delivered." The sun rose upon Jacob as he passed Penuel, limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the people of Israel do not eat the sinew of the thigh that is upon the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip on the sinew of the thigh. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts upon the scripture be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. One thing you can say about Jacob, he wasn't a quitter. Jacob may have been a stinker, he may have been a scoundrel and a little bit of a con artist, but he wasn't a quitter. For some people, that's the ultimate insult. After all, no one likes a quitter. If you're like most people, you would much rather have a reputation for being a person with a lot of drive and determination, a person who gets things done even when the odds are stacked against you. There's a story about a young man who met a person like that one day. The young man had a dream of becoming a newspaper reporter. Unfortunately, though, he lived in a small town where nothing exciting ever happened. All of that changed, however, when a dam broke and flooded the entire town with 6 feet of water. When that happened, the young man saw his opportunity. He quickly got into a rowboat and started paddling around the town looking for a story. Eventually, he saw a woman sitting on her roof. So he tied the rowboat up to a tree next to the house, then climbed up onto the roof with her. For the next hour or so, the two of them sat there and watched items float by. Each time they saw something, the woman would point and exclaim, "Now there's a story." The young man, however, would just shake his head and say, "No, that's not a story." After a while, they saw a hat float by. But then the hat stopped, did a 180-degree turn, and started floating back up the river, until it stopped again and did another 180-degree turn and started flowing back in the opposite direction. When the young man saw that, he jumped up and shouted, "Now there's a story." The woman, however, wasn't impressed. She just shook her head and said, "No, that's not a story. That's my husband, Hubert. He said that he was going to mow the lawn today, come hell or high water." Nobody likes a quitter. When you quit, you end up in a nursing home. When you quit, your marriage falls apart. When you quit, you flunk out of school. When you quit, people begin to shake their heads and look down on you. Well, Jacob wasn't a quitter. You can see that by looking at what happened that night when Jacob was on his way to meet his brother Esau. Now, one thing we know with absolute certainty, the meeting between Jacob and Esau wasn't going to be your typical run-of-the-mill, warm and fuzzy family reunion. After all, remember, this was Esau. You remember Esau. Esau was the brother who was cheated out of his inheritance. And who was it that cheated Esau out of his inheritance? If you were a contestant on the game show Family Feud and you said Jacob, everybody would start applauding and say, "Good answer, good answer." Esau was also the brother who had his blessing stolen from him, the blessing that he was supposed to receive from their father. And who was it that stole that blessing from Esau? Once again, it was Jacob. So when Jacob lay down that night and looked up at the sky and the stars above him, he had every reason to be anxious and afraid. You see, Jacob knew that Esau was on his way to meet him. And Jacob also knew that Esau was bringing with him 400 men. Now I ask you, does that sound like the beginnings of a welcome home party to you? No. Now, this is where things really get interesting. It's the middle of the night. Esau is on his way. Jacob is all alone. Suddenly, however, Jacob realizes that there's a shadowy stranger in the camp with him. Who was it? Was it Esau? Maybe. Or maybe it was someone sent by Esau to ambush Jacob and slit his throat in the middle of the night. Jacob couldn't be sure. So Jacob starts to wrestle with this shadowy stranger until the breaking of the day. As the sun is coming over the horizon, the shadowy figure says to Jacob, "Let me go, for the day has broken." Jacob, however, refuses to do that and says to the shadowy stranger, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." Jacob asks for that blessing because he doesn't know what's going to happen. And he wants to make sure that after everything is said and done, no harm comes to him. So Jacob says, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And that's what the stranger does. He blesses Jacob, and then he gives Jacob a new name. The shadowy stranger says to Jacob, "No longer shall your name be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have wrestled with men and with God and have prevailed." Now, it's only after Jacob receives that blessing that he realizes that this shadowy stranger wasn't a mere mortal man. This shadowy stranger was an angel sent by God, or maybe even God himself. That's why Jacob decides to call the name of that place Penuel. Jacob calls it Penuel because he says, "I have seen God face to face, and yet my life has been preserved." So in the end, Jacob receives a new name. By the way, in Hebrew, Israel literally means he who wrestles with God. So Jacob receives that new name, and he also receives that blessing. Now, we have to be absolutely clear here. God doesn't bless Jacob because he's a stinker. God doesn't bless Jacob because he's a scoundrel or because he's a little bit of a con artist. God blesses Jacob because he isn't a quitter. You see, God knows that as long as there's still a little fight left in Jacob, there's still hope for him. There's still hope that Jacob can turn his life around. There's still hope that Jacob can become the person God wanted him to be. There's still hope that Jacob can become a better person, a good and righteous father to the chosen people. That's why God blesses Jacob, because he wasn't a quitter. Friedrich Nietzsche, the German philosopher, once said, "That which does not kill me only makes me stronger." You've heard that saying, right? Well, to paraphrase Nietzsche, you could also say, that which does not kill you can make you a better person. When you don't quit, God can work with you and through you to make you a better person. Like Jacob, you may push back from time to time, and you may end up with a little bit of a limp. But that's okay as long as you don't quit. That's okay as long as you don't give up on yourself or the God who created you. Many years ago, there was an interesting conversation that took place during a broadcast of a Monday night football game. During the broadcast, the announcers were talking about some of the great running backs in NFL history. When they got to the late, great Walter Payton of the Chicago Bears, Frank Gifford said, "What a runner. Do you realize that altogether, Walter Payton gained more than 9 miles rushing during his career?" Just imagine that, more than 9 miles. At that point, Dan Dierdorf, the other announcer, chimed in and said, "And that was with someone knocking him down every 4.6 yards. God can work with you and through you as long as you don't quit. God can't do that if you live your life like the elderly man who lived in the Ozark Mountains down in Arkansas. One night, the elderly man and his wife were sitting in front of the fireplace watching the fire and passing the evening away. After a while, the wife pointed to the window and said, "Jed, I think it's raining outside. Why don't you go out and see?" The old man ignored her. But then when she mentioned it again, he just shook his head and said, "Aw, Ma, why can't we just call the dog in and see if it's wet?" God can work with you and through you as long as you don't quit. Just look at what happened to Jacob. Just look at what happened to John Wesley and what John Wesley wrote in his diary. Now, Pastor Fisher and our friends from Aldersgate here in town will tell you that John Wesley was the man who founded the Methodist Church. This is what he wrote in his diary. "Sunday morning, May 5th, preached at St. Anne's, was asked not to come back anymore. Sunday afternoon, May 5th, preached at St. John's. Deacon said, get out and stay out. Sunday morning, May 12th, preached at St. Jude's. Can't go back there either. Sunday morning, May 19th, preached at somebody's St. Else. Deacons called special meeting and said I couldn't return. Sunday afternoon, May 19th, preached on street, kicked off street. Sunday morning, May 26th, preached in meadow, chased out of meadow as bull was turned loose during service. Sunday morning, June 2nd, preached out at the edge of town, kicked off the highway. Sunday afternoon, June 2nd, preached in a pastor. 10,000 people came out to hear me." John Wesley is the founder of the Methodist movement because he didn't quit. Jacob is the founder of the Jewish people, the father of the Jewish people, because he didn't quit. God's grace and God's goodness will come to you when you don't quit. Amen.